Today is the seventh day of the sixth month on our Maker's Restored calendar. It is the 27th day of the seventh month on his servant Satan's calendar. It is the 100th day of the 360 days of his perfect one smooth stone. I discussed the significance of the timing of today's blood moon in relation to tomorrow in yesterday's video that was called The Blood Moon and the River Kabar. I'm going to expand on this significance in this video. Before I do so though, I want to point out an error that I made in yesterday's video. I said that the count up clock that is on the repairingthebreach.info website will click over to 135 days tomorrow morning at 7:34, completing the 135th day, and this was not correct. It will click over to 134 days at this time, completing the 134th day. Therefore, after 7:34 a.m., it will be the 135th day from 7:34 a.m. on the 24th day of the first month. It will be the 139th Sabbath of the 1,290 days of his servant Daniel's chapter 12 prophecy. This anniversary of the day that he caused my predecessor Moses' faces to shine after he came down from his holy mountain Horeb after the 80th night, that was also the first day of my predecessor Elijah's 40 days and 40 nights upon Horeb, will host the 104th Silver Trumpet Assembly at his house. This day will be the 580th day of him causing his end-time Elijah, end-time Moses, to petition him three times per day on his holy mountain. 580 parallels the 58 years that his servants Noah and Abraham's lives overlapped. It will be the 20,350th day of his end-time son of Adam's life. These 350 days, past 20,000 days, parallels the 350 years that he caused his servant Noah to live after he set forth the flood in the 600th year of his life. The longest blood moon of the century, aka 100-year period of time, was happening over Jerusalem as I was typing the notes for this video. I can assure you that it is not a coincidence that this event was happening on the 100th day of his perfect one smooth stone. Jerusalem is currently 10 hours ahead of the place that he has chosen for his name to dwell at this time, which is in the western part of the chief seat of the scattered descendants of Israel. I blew the shofar for the first of the three petitions to him on today's 579th day of petitioning him three times per day on his holy mountain Zion at 12:29 p.m. According to timeanddate.com, today's total lunar eclipse entered into its fully eclipsed stage at 10:30:15 p.m. Jerusalem time. This was at 12:30:15 p.m. at Kikwe's house. Since it takes me probably a minute to walk up the seven Zadok steps and across the courtyards of his house to approach near to him after I blow the shofar, I was sitting down to wash my dual hands and my dual feet to approach near to him precisely when this blood moon entered into its totality phase. I in absolutely no way planned this. The duration of today's eclipse that was in one of the dual Jerusalems was 6 hours, 13 minutes, and 51 seconds. 6 hours and 13 minutes parallels the 613 days that separated the dual 1,260-day periods that he wove into his witness against the scattered descendants of Israel. 51 seconds parallels the third tier of 51 days that we are now in. The duration of the totality phase of this blood moon was 1 hour, 42 minutes and 56 seconds from Jerusalem's point of view. This was 4 seconds shy of the 1 hour and 43 minutes that it was totally eclipsed elsewhere on this planet. Yahweh set forth this blood moon on the fourth day of the 7 days of his Isaiah chapter 8 prophetess's ninth messenger of blood. These 4 seconds also parallel the 4 offspring that are in this Shulamite's womb and his 4 messengers of blood that were bound in the great Euphrates River that he set forth to put these 4 offspring into her womb. I spoke about the significance of 1 hour and 43 minutes being 103 minutes in relation to his 103rd silver trumpet assembly that was on this past head of the sixth month day in the last video. This 1 hour parallels the 7 days of the final 1 hour of his judgment that these four messengers of blood identified. 42 minutes parallels the 42 months of the 1,260 days of his witness against the scattered descendants of Israel. 56 parallels the 56 days that he orchestrated at the end of his 377 day account of the flood. He opened the door of the three tiers of this boat 56 days after he caused his servant Noah to remove the covering from it. The maximum phase of this blood moon was at 11:21:44 p.m. in Jerusalem. This was at 1:21:44 according to his house. 1:21 is the last day of his 7 day feast of that which is unleavened. The 1,260 days of his 42 month witness against the scattered descendants of Israel followed this last day of this feast 6 years ago. 44 parallels things like the 44 books of his word when you take out the books that are not his word from it, and the dual 440-day periods that he orchestrated as part of his end-time timeline after the 1,260 days of his witness against you ended. 11 parallels his prophecy that is for 11 days journey and the signature verse of his Isaiah chapter 55 signature ring that he's put upon my hand. 21 parallels the 21 days of his servant Daniel's days of 3/7. I can keep going with discussing the parallels to the rest of the times that timeanddate.com provided for this blood moon event in Jerusalem for the end of the totality phase and the beginning and the end of the penumbral phase and the beginning and the end of the partial phase. But I have got other things that I want to discuss in this video that are truly amazing and more pertinent, and I'm limited on time. I will, however, discuss one more of them that is the most significant of all of them. This fourth day of blood moon event ended at 2:28 and 38 seconds in Jerusalem. 2:28 is the last day of the 7 days of the hour of his judgment next year. What these parallels show is that he is in control of every single nanosecond here on earth and in his dual heavens. He sent forth the 38th shaking at Kilauea yesterday to usher in this event. 38 parallels his dual 38-year death sentences that he has sent forth upon those that were at that time and are at this time 20 years old and upward as of the first day of the second month of the dual generations of his dual exoduses, one of which is at hand at this time. This 38th shaking was another 5.3. Today is the 16th day of the 102 days of our Maker opening wide his end-time Son of Adam's mouth for me to be able to call down fire from his dual heavens. This 16th day parallels the 16 days of Operation Grapes of Wrath that he set forth upon the White Mountain, aka Lebanon, 22 years ago. The revelations of his only begotten Son use grapes in association with the wine press of his wrath. He does so in relation to your blood flowing to the depth of a horse's bridle for 1,600 furlongs. Yahweh has reared up his house in an area of a mountain chain that is called the White Mountains at this time, and at this time he is going to reverse things. He is going to turn the tables upright. 1,600 furlongs is 200 miles. 200 parallels the 200-mile-long Jordan River and the Most High turning the waters into blood through the dual hands of his dual sons of his anointing oil. There are 200 days that encompass today's fourth day of blood moon, and the anniversary of the day that he caused his servant Noah to let loose the second dove. This dove brought back an olive branch. His word refers to his dual sons of his anointing oil as both olive branches and olive trees. Him sending forth this Eastern Hemisphere fourth day of blood moon on this sixth day from his absolutely incredible 6-1 waypoint indicator is truly amazing. I say that 6-1 was absolutely incredible because of all of the absolutely incredible details that he marked it with. These 6 days are the first 6 work days of his 6th month that take us to tomorrow's 7th day Sabbath that is on the 8th day of this month. He set forth today's 4th day of blood moon, 120 days or 4 restored 30-day months from the anniversary of the 7th day of the 7-day march that he orchestrated around Jericho. Jericho means the stench of a month. He caused the walls that were around the stench of a month to come tumbling down at that time. His restored 30-day months contain his restored 7th-day Sabbaths and the rest of his restored appointed times in them. Your perversions of his Sabbaths and the rest of his appointed times that are in your perversions of his months are a stench in his nose. He orchestrated a similitude of this 7-day march around Jericho around the courtyards of his house. The 7th and last day of this march around the courtyards of his house was a year and 4 months prior to today's 16th day blood moon. A year and 4 months is 16 months. What are the odds? He caused the 5 people that dwell at his house to petition him to cause your walls to come crashing down around your stenches of a month as we marched around the courtyards of his house those 7 days. Since the 7th day had 7 laps, as did the 7th day at Jericho, the 7th lap around the courtyards of his house was the 13th lap. This was also 6 days followed by a 7th day that was different, paralleling the here and him raising me up after 7 days as well. He sent forth the 3 tiers of 3 consecutive supermoons over the course of a 1,300-day period of time in order to tie this 13th lap into the here and now and today's 4th day of blood moon. He has also sent forth several tiers of 4 blood moons that are known as tetrads over the last 2,000 years that he has orchestrated to line up with Judaism's perversions of his Passover memorial and his dual 7-day harvest feast. The last time that he did so was during the last 2 years of his 42-month witness against you. In light of these 4 blood moon tetrads lining up the way that he caused them to with Judaism's perversions of his months that are also a stench in his nose, is it a coincidence that he set forth today's blood moon on his Isaiah chapter 8 prophetess 4th day of blood on her 9th issue of blood? The significance of today's blood moon being sent forth 4 restored 30-day months or 120 days after the 1 smooth stone anniversary of the 7th day of the march around his house is he rose up his servant David to be king after an undisclosed number of days in 4 months. This is recorded in 1 Samuel 27:7. And the days that David dwelt in the land of the Philistines were a number of days and 4 months. It was after this four-month period of time that Yahweh had Saul killed and he rose up his servant David. This event testifies that he is going to begin to raise me up to be your king after a 4-month period as well. These 120 days also parallel the 120 years of life that my predecessor Moses lived to be and the combined total of 120 days that he caused my predecessors Moses and Elijah to be upon his holy mountain. They also parallel the 12 myriads of Adam of his Jonah, aka the dove prophecy. The 12 myriads of Adam that were in the great Elohim-like city of Nineveh turned back at the preaching of the dove, and behold, a greater than the dove has been sent to you at this time, and you have failed to do so. Also, his only begotten son said the following in John 4, verse 35. Do you not say there are yet 4 months and the harvest comes? Behold, I say to you, lift up your eyes and look at the field, that they are white to harvest even now. A tier of this was at the time of his first fruit harvest. And since Yahweh's word is extremely uniform in design, another tier of this prophecy is he is also going to begin to gather the planting of the remnant for this era of time after a 4-month period. In the last video, I said that there are 63 days that encompass today's fourth day of blood moon, and his fifth day of the fourth month in time, Son of Adam waypoint. I said that the significance of these 63 days is they parallel his Psalms chapter 63 prophecy and his small cloud that is like the palm of a man's hand, Elijah Mount Carmel calling down fire from his dual heavens, seven strokes prophecy. The reason that Psalm 63 parallels his small cloud that is like the palm of a man's hand, Elijah Mount Carmel calling down fire from his dual heavens, seven strokes prophecy, is because of an event that he orchestrated when he was plucking me out from the filth and the swill of Christianity. I was conducting a men's Bible study that was called The Quest for Authentic Manhood. At the end of this 24-week series, I was asking a question that was in the workbook for this DVD study. This question was along the lines of, what is an authentic man of Elohim? I was listening to the answers as I circled around the table with this question, and the men were giving me the answers that this study of the leavened bread of man had taught them during the 24 weeks of this study, and I started shouting and pounding upon the table with the closed palm of my hand, screaming, no, 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 this is an authentic man of Elohim. And I randomly flung my Bible open to Psalm 63, and I read the verses that were in front of my dual eyes. The small cloud that was like the palm of a man's hand that Yahweh showed to his servant, Elijah's servant, the seventh stroke that this lad rose up to look, represented me pounding the palm of my hand upon the table that day. This seventh stroke represents him raining down his wrath upon you after a seventh stroke. I will read this psalm to you. It is clearly an end-time prophecy that Yahweh gave to us through his servant David. Yahweh gave it to us while his servant David was in the wilderness of Judah. Fled in the wilderness into the wilderness of Judah. He did so in order to parallel his end-time messenger of his covenant being fled into the wilderness at this time. So it starts off, Elohim Mael, I wake up seeking you. My life thirsts for you and my flesh yearns for you in a parched and barren land where there are no waters, so that I can look upon you in your holy place and see your power and your glory. The parched and barren land where there are no waters parallels the famine of hearing his word and his not yet bringing forth the physical waters out from the boulder design of his house. The Hebrew word for Zion means a stone marker that is in a dry and parched land. There are 63 petitions to him in 21 days, and today is the 21st day, or 3/7 of the third tier of 51 days that we are now in. Therefore, today's third petition to him was number 63 on this 21st day, 63rd day waypoint. My life thirsts for him and my flesh yearns for him to bring this to pass in order to cause his righteousness to be exalted in judgment and his desire to be done on earth, here on earth as it is in his dual heavens. I yearn to look upon his power and his glory in accomplishing the planting of the millennium. Verse 3, my dual lips soothe you because your favor is better than life. He uses the dual grammar notation 5 times in the 11 verses of this psalm, paralleling his servant David's 5 smooth stones that he took with him to go smite the uncircumcised Philistine. The 9-foot-9-inch-tall uncircumcised Philistine. Verse 4, and I lift up my dual palms in your name, so I will bless you while I live. This verse parallels my father causing me to lift up my right hand and my left hand to his dual heavens, and to 7 by him that lives forever, that we are in the appointed time, dual appointed times, at half of an appointed time, per his Daniel chapter 12 prophecy, which is the appointed time, dual appointed times, at half of an appointed time of his Revelation chapter 12 prophecy, that the wife is fled into the wilderness upon the dual wings of a great eagle. Verse 5, as with the ash of the choice, my life is satisfied with the dual lips of my mouth boasting your heraldings. The ash of the choice is a prophetic reference to the ash that results from the burning of the hair of the Nazarite at the end of the 80 days of their vow of separation to Yahweh that is burnt up upon his altar. How his Nazarite vow has put completeness upon his altar, per These Are the Truths, chapter 33, is discussed in other videos. The boasting of his heraldings is referring to my setting his greatness in place and by crying out the acceptable day and the year of his wrath and the rest of the proclamations that he has sent me with to set his greatness in place. My life is indeed satisfied with these things. They are sweet as honey to my mouth. However, they are also bitter to the belly because you have not listened to him. This psalm clearly describes the authentic man of Elohim that he caused me to read to that group of men back in 2007 on his servant Satan's calendar. Verse 6, when I mark you upon my bed and ponder on you in the night watches, I sing with joy in the shadow of your dual wings because you are my help. His dual wings parallel the dual wings of the great eagle of the appointed times, dual appointed times, and half of an appointed time that the wife is fled into the wilderness upon, per chapter 12 of the revelations of his only begotten son. My life cleaves after you, and your right hand holds me up. His right hand is his only begotten son who is dwelling in me. These verses are the heart of an authentic man of Elohim. Verse 9, and those that search for the devastation of my life will go into the lower parts of the earth. They will be poured out upon the dual hands of the sword and be a portion for the wild dogs. Those that search for the devastation of my life are those of you that hope for that which I have put my hope in and my trust in to not come to pass. In seeking for this, you are seeking for his word to not come to pass. I have some bad news for you. His word is going to come to pass. Upon the dual hands of the judgment of Yahweh's word is referring to the dual hands of his two witnesses, his two anointed sons. Verse 11, and the king will rejoice in Elohim, and all that summon to you will boast, because the mouth of those that speak that which is false will be stopped. Yahweh caused my predecessor Elijah to confront 450 prophets of Baal and 400 prophets of the groves at the time that he set forth the small cloud that is like the palm of a man's hand on the seventh stroke. 450 days ago was 5-3 last year on his servant Satan's calendar. 5-3 parallels the 53 days from his first messenger of blood delivery waypoint to his second that we are now in. This day was the seventh day of the third month on his restored calendar. The significance of this day is it was one of the seventh day waypoints that were associated with one of his dual waters of Meribah events that I thought might be when he was going to raise me up before your faces after 6 days. On the sixth day that preceded this day, which was 3-6, one of the does that we still had at that time kitted, and she brought forth twins that we named Bethany and Bubba. I called Bethany my sixth day goat. I did so because of Yahweh's dual six-day prophecies that he gave to us in association with the town Bethany, and because she was born on the sixth day. The Shulamite did not think of these prophecies in choosing this name. There are 6 days of his account of him raising up Lazarus from the dead at Bethany through the hand of his only begotten son, and Mary anointed Yeshua's dual feet with the expensive aromatic oil at Bethany 6 days before he was killed. The significance of these dual six-day periods in association with Bethany is they parallel the vision that Yahweh gave to Yeshua and his three disciples, Peter, John, and James, in association with my predecessors Elijah and Moses and the private mountain. This vision testifies that Yahweh is going to cause my faces to shine after a six-day period of time. Yeshua was on his way to Jerusalem from Bethany when he cursed the fig tree on account of it not having any fruit. This cursing of the fig tree is one of the many prophecies that testify that the Almighty is going to uncover his almighty arm in the summer. 400 days prior to today's blood moon, paralleling the 400 prophets of the groves, was the 27th day of the fourth month last year. The 27th day of the fourth month was his servant Moses' 40th day upon his holy mountain. This 400-day mark also parallels the 400 years of Abraham's vision that was for when the captives would be set free at this time. 850 days prior to today's fourth day of blood moon, paralleling the combined 450 prophets of Baal and the 400 prophets of the groves, was 127, 20 days short of 2.5 years ago. Yahweh wove a very significant tear of my resurrection from the dead into this day this year, 10 days after the second smooth stone anniversary of the massive heart attack that he gave upon me at the time that the uncircumcised Philistines were trampling his altar under their filthy feet. 2.5 years later would make the here and the now in the third year from this waypoint. He sent forth his servant Elijah to confront Ahab and these 850 false prophets in the third year. This is recorded in the first verse of this 1 Kings chapter 18 prophecy. My predecessor Elijah healed Yahweh's altar that day at Carmel with 12 stones. This is recorded in verses 30 and 31. I will read these verses to you. And Elijah said to all of the people, come near to me, and all of the people came near to him, and he healed the altar of Yahweh that was thrown down. And Elijah took 12 stones according to the number of the rods of the sons of Jacob, whom Yahweh's word was to, saying, Israel shall be your name. Counting today's fourth day of blood moon waypoint, which is the second day of the 3 days journey from his 6-5 waypoint, we are 30 days from his second messenger blood delivery waypoint of his 4 messenger blood delivery waypoints that he has orchestrated to bring forth the Emmanuel man-child Mahershalal Kushbaz and his 3 siblings. And counting yesterday, the first day of the 3-day journey from his 6-5 son of Adam waypoint, we were 31 days from this second delivery waypoint. This healing is referring to the healing that he has sent me with. These 12 stones are symbolic of the 12 stones that have the 34 chapters of his truths that his servant Moses spoke to our ancestors on the first day of the 11th month written upon them. They were written upon these 12 stones with his Ezekiel chapter 9 writer's inkhorn. If you want to be healed, you need to turn back to doing that which is written upon these 12 great stones. They are 12 of the 46 great whitewashed stones that make up his Ezekiel chapter 43 boulder design of his house. There being 46 of them parallel the 46 years that he caused it to take our ancestors to build the second house that he caused to be built under his name. Today's fourth day of blood moon waypoint is 46 days after the 6th smooth stone anniversary of the scattering of the last 1/3 of my hair. My predecessor Elijah had a conduit dug around this altar that day. We are told this in the next verse. He tells us in verse 32, and he built an altar in Yahweh's name with the 12 stones, and he made a conduit around the altar as the house of dual measures of seed, i.e. as the house of dual measures of offspring. This conduit parallels the dual conduits that he has caused to be dug at this time at his house. Before he uncovered his Mahershalal Kushbaz prophecy to us, he revealed a couple of tiers of parallels of these dual measures of offspring to us. The first tier is these dual measures of offspring parallel the dual phases of his first fruit harvest. The second tier overlapped this first tier because one of these dual measures parallels his first fruit harvest and the other parallels the latter harvest into his eternal realm. However, now that we have reached this point in time with him sending forth fire from his dual heavens, this prophecy ultimately represents the dual measures of the dual sets of twins that are currently in the Shulamite's womb. In his Song of Solomon Shulamite prophecy, he gives us 4 references to twins, putting an emphasis upon twins and upon his 4 messengers of blood. When he does so, he uses 2 different words to do so. One of these words means coupled together and the other means twins. The Hebrew word for twins is used 4 times in his word, doubling this emphasis upon his 4 messengers of blood in association with twins. The other 2 times is where he speaks of Rebekah's twins Esau and Jacob and Tamar's twins Phares and Zerah. The 2 places that this word for twins are used in the Song of Solomon are where he uses this word to describe the Shulamites' 2 sets of dual breasts being as the twins of the female splendor and as the stags. And he doubles this 2 sets of dual breasts description in this prophecy. He does so in order to put an extra emphasis upon it. 2 sets of dual breasts refer to 4 nursing children. The female splendor is used in its singular form when he does so, and in as in the one female child Rachel, and the stags are plural, as in the two twins Zechariah and Uriah, and Rachel's twin brother Maher-Shalal-Kushbaz. This word for stag is used five times in the testimony of his word, and all five places are here, are in this song of his beloved. The other three places are used to describe this Shulamite's beloved. Because today's fourth day blood moon was in July, it was also what is called a full buck moon, or a full stag moon, and it was also what is called a thunder moon, according to the old farmer's almanac. He is indeed getting ready to thunder forth. This verse in 1 Kings says dual measures of seed. However, he also uses the word for seed to refer to a man's offspring that comes from his seed. Even back in 2014, in a video that was called A Red Line, which was long before I knew anything about him sending forth his holy seed and Maher-Shalal-Kushbaz, Gateway caused me to translate this verse with the word offspring instead of seed. One of the reasons that we can know that these dual measures of offspring are ultimately referring to these dual sets of twins is because the following verse tells us in verse 33, and he, referring to Elijah, set the timbers in place, and he cut up the bullock and put it upon the timbers and said, fill four pitchers with waters and pour them upon the burnt offering and upon the timbers. And he said, do it a second time. And they did it a second time. And he said, do it a third time. And they did it a third time. These three times parallel all of the many, many tears of three times and even 3 days that the Most High has woven into the testimony of his word. And because these three times are associated with these four pitchers of waters, they parallel Kickway four messengers of blood that he has set forth as part of him sending forth the Emmanuel man-child, Maher-Shalal-Kushbaz, and his three siblings through three of his four messenger of blood delivery waypoints. And so do all of the rest of his references to three of this or that in relation to a fourth that he gave to us as matters of end-time prophecies. He has now sent forth nine messengers of blood in doing so. However, there are only four of these nine that involved his holy seed going into the Shulamite to conceive these four offspring. The 12 stones of the boulder design of his house that have his truths written upon them with his Ezekiel chapter 9 writer's inkhorn are three tiers of his house, each having four stones. These three tiers are the four horns of his altar and the four corners of the greater settle of his altar and the four corners of the lower settle of it. On the fifth day of the fourth month this year, Gateway set forth an extremely strong wind from the east that tossed six of the seven glass pitchers that hold the seven lamps that light his house each night into a pile of broken rubble. Yet only one of them was burst. This event was his fulfillment of part of his Ecclesiastes chapter 12 prophecy. This fifth day of the fourth month event was 32 days prior to today's fourth ninth messenger of blood, Blood Moon. This event also paralleled today's sixth day and tomorrow's seventh day. And so does the seven strokes of his small cloud that is like the palm of a man's hand, Elijah Mount Carmel, calling down fire from his dual heavens prophecy. Gateway sent down fire from his dual heavens that consumed his servant Elijah's bullock and even the 12 stones and licked up the waters that filled the conduit that was filled as a result of the 12 pitchers of waters. Here is what his servant Elijah told the people when they gathered to see what was going to come to pass that day. In verse 21, and Elijah came to all of the people and said, how long will you limp between two opinions? If Gateway is Elohim, then follow him. But if Baal is Elohim, then follow him. And the people answered him not a word. Those of you who are in the blasphemous religion of Christianity say that the Elohim of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel is our maker. However, you limp between two opinions of who he is. You claim that he is the image of an Elohim that is not testified to by his word. Yet you say you believe his word. You're a bunch of hypocrites. The Hebrew word for Baal simply means master or husband. your make-believe images of who Yahweh is that you love and worship are not the image of Him that His Word testifies to. You can't throw out His Word altogether because you know that His Word is what testifies to His only begotten Son. However, you have cast His Word out from your hearts by letting the abomination of desolation, Saul of Tarsus, disannul His Word. In doing so, you are limping between two opinions of who He is. And in loving and worshiping your make-believe images of Him and His only begotten Son, you have played the whore to Him. You have loved and worshiped a different master and husband. And we have now come to the point in time that He is going to make good on His promise to reward you on account of your doing so. His word that you have disannulled in your hearts is very descriptive in describing to us how He is going to manifest His hot indignation at this time upon those of you that have played the whore to Him. Nearly all of you are going to be enraged at Him when He sends forth this time of Jacob's trouble upon you instead of being accountable for what you have done and ashamed of your nakedness. This is simply a reality that His word testifies to. The good news for those that love His righteousness is those who don't are going to be purged from before His faces, and His desire is going to be done here on earth as it is in His dual heavens. His word says so.